Hey y'all, it's Kendall.
And John.
And we're the Antonellis of Antonelli's Tea Shop in Austin, Texas. We are here today, tonight, whenever it is for you, to do a cheese and honey tasting.
This is going to be awesome. I love honey and cheese.
I mean, honestly, there are a few more perfect pairings, I think, because cheese is salty and honey is sweet. Now, we're going to get into much more of the complexities of that because honey is so much more than sweet and can actually be herbaceous and fruity and floral and all of these other things. And oftentimes we don't think of that with honey when we just think of it as all the same and sweet. And instead, we get to explore all sorts of different honey. Sage honey, orange blossom honey. We're going to talk about what it means to be a single varietal honey.
Okay. I'm so excited. But what, like...
I'm getting ahead of myself, y'all.
Yeah, let's get them set up. Let's get you guys, some drink if you want. Kendall and I always recommend bubbles.
Bubbles. Even if you don't drink alcohol, sparkling water is great. Alcoholic or non-alcoholic, you follow that. Sparkling ciders. Ciders would be perfect. Sparkling wines. We're both doing sparkling rosé today. We always say do what you love because that's the most important thing. However, this is the one class I would say that I really don't think reds are the way to go, honestly.
No, I don't think so.
The honeys are such delicate flavor profiles that even if you're doing beer or wine, I would stick to something on the lighter side. Yeah. And bubbles are great because of the effervescence. Cheese is fatty and palate coating, and the bubbles does this work of aromatizing the whole pairing in your mouth and making it more flavorful. So anyway, our recommendation today is any sort of bubbles, whether it's got alcohol on it or not, and something of the lighter varietal. Lighter color.
Okay. I think that's amazing. And if you do not yet have a plate that looks something like our plate, we definitely recommend taking some time, unwrap all the cheeses, take some time cutting, plating, either portion for a group on a big board like this or create individual plates. That way, as we're going through this tasting together, you don't have to fumble with anything. You just get to enjoy.
Sit back and relax and treat yourself, which you don't get to do if you're doing the work. So if you missed it, there is an accompanying plating video. You can just hit pause right now, go watch the 10-minute plating video, set your board up, and then come back and be ready to relax. And for those of you who've already done it, let's get started. So we've got our mise en place here, which usually is a term in the kitchen. For a line cook or chef who has everything ready to go on their station, which will help them execute everything very quickly. For us, it means we've got our drink. We also have our water palate cleanser. We've got our cheese board in front of us. We've got our two menus, which we've plated to, and starting at 12 o'clock is our first one. And it goes, we're gonna go clockwise all the way down and around. Same thing with our pairings. I have a little spreader, but I also say wash your hands because we want you to touch the cheese and get
play
up
with
close
your
and personal. And last but not least, I forget this in this class every time, y'all. Scissors. You can just bite the caps off these honeys, but if you don't want to do that and spend that time, you can easily just snip it. So scissors is in
scissors
our
are
class
super helpful for this particular class because as we wanted to focus on model floral single varieties, it is really difficult to find a wide assortment of those in shapes and sizes that will fit in boxes. And when we were able, this was a project that I spent months and months on, when we were finally able to find the sources for these monofloral honey sticks, it opened the world for us. And so it's kind of nostalgic for me. I remember the few times in my life as a kid, like at a camp or something, getting a honey stick and enjoying it. And those were probably polyfloral honeys, or some of them were like flavored like watermelon and stuff. And today we get to do a deep dive into one of my favorite areas of food, which is honey. And because, we've spent so many years becoming certified cheese professionals.
That's the thing, y'all. Certified cheese professionals coming at you.
honey is one of those avenues that I only really started exploring since opening this cheese shop, and that the depth of flavors, the nuances that you can get, the experiences that you have are just astonishing. And so I'm super pumped to be with y'all today. I'm super pumped to be eating this with you, my love.
Okay, so thank you, honey. I should just pause. Thanks. I appreciate being with you today too, spending this time with you. Okay, we're always, when you're married to your life partner, to your business partner, to the partner of your children, it's just go all the time. And so thank you for taking that pause and just appreciating me and where we are today. So some guidelines for enjoyment. do it how you want, but we'd say stick with us if you can. I'm going to talk about the style of cheese, and then we're going to talk about the cheese itself, and we'll invite you to eat it at that time. And then we'll talk about the honey. When you eat the cheese first, eat it naked or in the buff. So put it just straight on your palate. And that's because we want you to taste the cheese. If you smear it right on that cracker and bite the cracker, you're really going to get cracker first. So we want you to get to know these cheeses. And then once you've tried it, then you can enjoy it however you want. Let's see. Try not to jump ahead because the flavor progression matters on your palate. For instance, if you eat blue, you're going to just taste blue the whole rest of the time. And then our last little tip and trick is save a little bit back of each pairing. One, it's fun to mix and match and see what other combinations work better or work for your palate. And two, we always want you to end on your favorite bite. And if you eat them all up and then you don't like the last bite, then you're ending on a bad note. And we want you to end on that perfect bite.
The best bite.
Okay.
Whatever that means to you.
So we always kick this off with a little grounding exercise, defining flavor and calibrating our palates. So I'm gonna throw it over to you, John.
Perfect. Sounds awesome. All right. So what I want you to do today, we're gonna mix it up just a little bit, have some fun. Let's see how this works.
Getting crazy.
What I want you to do is you should have figs on your plate. And what I want is these dried Mission figs. What I want you to do is take one, pinch your nose, take a bite of your fig and chew and pay attention.
You can breathe out of your mouth, but try not to breathe out of your mouth.
Yes, and if you're allergic to figs, don't do this. Take a bite and start chewing. Pay attention to the texture, the sound. Your tongue might pick up one or two of five things: salty, sweet, sour, bitter, and umami. And when you're like, I know what this is, release your nose and exhale out through the back of your nostril.
My eyes are watering right now.
Why? That's okay. Amazing.
You keep going. I'll tell you why.
I can't wait to try that. I've never done that with a fig. But what's crazy about this is that your tongue really picks up five things: salt, sweet, sour, bitter, and umami. And when you don't have your olfactory participating in this experience, that's all you get. And olfactory is such a powerful tool that we have at our disposal. Because over the course of all of our lifetimes, we've been developing these taste memories, these aroma memories. So we like to say that taste plus aroma equals flavor. And so incorporating your olfactory into this experience is incredibly essential. And hopefully, Kendall, that was what just happened with the fig.
Y'all, so I want to know what happens when John does it and what happens when you do it. I've never done this with the fig. And I don't know, the one fig I had was a little more moist than dried figs normally are. I got sour. It was like sour on my palate. And I don't know if it's that we stayed up a little bit late last night or, so that's why we're all kind of calibrating together. I want to do it with a different fig. But I did not taste wow. Fig at all. I just got the texture and something that was tart or so maybe it was tart. Acid. I don't know.
Yeah. I got a little acid, but mostly sweet for me.
So I got none of the sweetness. That's why, maybe it's this fig.
You're
I got to do something
with
else.
This fig?
Either way, the point of the exercise is when I then unplugged my nose and breathed out, that's when I got that earthiness, that figginess, everything that I associate with the fig.
Deep, dark fruit
the
flavor.
The fruit. I didn't get any of that when it was just on my palate. So again, palate, sweet, salt, bitter, sour, umami. That's it. So in all the world of food and all the amazing different diverse tastes and flavors, most of that comes through aroma. So why do we tell you that? It's so that you take your time to enjoy these products. Not only are they labors of love, and artisans have put so much care and craft and art and science into painstakingly creating these cheeses and or harvesting this honey, but also that people, when they go to a wine tasting, they know to like slow down and you swirl it and you look at it and you smell it. What's the aroma bouquet? You take a sip, you swirl it around on your palate. Then when you swallow, you think about the finish. And then they just like mindlessly pop back a piece of cheese. So our goal is that you use and you engage all of your senses at the same time while you're eating these cheeses. So we're going to visually look at them. What does the color of it look like? What does that mean and signal to your brain that it might taste like? What is the sound? A squeaky cheese curd is not a squeaky cheese curd if it doesn't squeak. It's the same thing as when you eat a stale potato chip. It almost... you think it tastes different just because it's stale, but the flavor is actually the exact same. It is just that it changes the experience of it. So we're going to engage all those senses as we go through
this.
I'm going to do this in a minute because
you're
I got to talk.
Yeah, that's fair.
But I got to go back and do that because I've never had that sour. I'm going to put this one aside. Something's wrong. Okay, you try it while I start talking. But pinch your nose.
I will.
Okay. Maybe my palate is off today, y'all. Which actually brings us to one other good point before we get started.
Not sour.
That's a sour dried fig. I have never had that. Okay. So if anybody else out there gets the random, it's like Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. I got a golden ticket.
Wow, that's crazy.
So, that's cool. We should pre-calibrate our dried figs. Wait, what I was about to say is everybody's palate is unique and it's like a fingerprint. And so if we say we taste something, most of the time it's generally agreed upon flavor profiles for these styles of cheeses, but you may not taste that and it doesn't mean you're wrong. You can train your palate to be more in tune to some of these tastes and flavors, but your palate is unique to you and it's your own. And it may be that to your palate, you actually just don't taste dark notes of cherry or whatever it is.
Or
so
bitter,
just know that you're not wrong.
Yeah. Yeah, there's certain aspects of life. If you grew up eating a very particular style of food, you know, your taste memories relate back to that. And so you might not connect those dots if you've never had certain types of food. And so it really is your perception, your perceived experience. And that's what the joy is in eating. Sharing, breaking bread, being together. Eating is one of the greatest connectors on the planet. And so I am excited to do that with you. And I'm excited to share these honeys. So now that we've got our tastes calibrated, we're ready to use all of our senses.
Yes, the fig I tried, by the way, was sweet. So I don't know what that one fig is.
It was one.
All right, I'm going to start it off.
Well, I was thinking why don't I talk about honey for a few minutes?
I would love that since this is, so if you didn't know, this was a pandemic pivot for us to launch this. And as far as we know, we were the first and only ones in the nation doing these on-demand curated tasting experiences. So we have a cheese 101, which is 7 different cheeses and then all different pairings like charcuterie, jams, what else is in there? It's all different pairings. So if you like a little bit of
different
everything,
things, meats,
we have a cheese and chocolate box. We have this cheese and honey box
and a cheese and meat box
and then a cheese and meat box. And so, yes, I forgot. Why don't you tell us a little bit more about honey as we ground into our tasting?
I love it. That's awesome.
I'm going to drink some rosé while you do it.
Please go ahead.
Cheers.
So honey, monofloral. So there's two types of honeys that we would talk about, monofloral and polyfloral. So polyfloral is multiple blossoms, types of flowers, and monofloral is a singular type of pollen. And so beekeepers and honeybees have a really natural coexistence together because they rely on each other significantly throughout the course of their lifetime, hive management, locations. Honeybees are one of the most intelligent creatures on the planet. They are a keystone species. So keystone species means that in the ecosystem in which they live, they are the primary, keystone. They are the primary organism that makes everything work. And so the honeybees pollinate most of the flowers, seeds, you name it, that exist in the ecosystems where they live and thrive. That's creating vegetation for other animals to eat. That's creating ground cover in some cases for other organisms to survive. And so they become such an important essential component of these ecosystems. There are a handful of other keystone species across the globe. Bison was one of them on the Great Plains long, long time ago before all the fences got put up. But we are in a moment where certain bee colonies, certain bee habitats are being destroyed. And so in many ways, by supporting these amazing honey makers, we are creating opportunity for honeybees to be supported throughout different geographic locations.
And it is, sometimes you have to put your mind on it because it seems like a paradox. Wait, by eating honey, we are
saving
the bees.
Species.
But you are, because you're creating a demand for it. So beekeepers will put resources towards harvesting these honeys because they can make a living off doing it, which then means more protection for bees in the process.
Yeah. And the research increases as well, and so it can help solve the crises. And so what we specialize in the business in is monofloral honey. So monofloral means that over 90% of the honey that is in a jar, in a stick, is coming from one type of flower. And the reason why we like this kind of experience is because you get the essence of that bud, of that flower, of that plant or shrub or whatever it is. And bees are super intelligent. And so with just a little bit of help from the beekeepers, bees have this natural like GPS. They know where the best pollen is and they go to it. And so when these short windows of opportunity exist, the bees take full advantage of it. And so for instance, like a, let's say Tupelo gum tree only blossoms really for 14 days. And so in that moment, the beekeeper and the bees have to work in harmony to capture what is this, one of the finest honeys on the planet. You know, and the danger here though, is, you know, is if there's a bad weather event during that 14 days, that can wipe out an entire year's worth of stuff. And we make sure that when we're working with beekeepers, that we are honoring what they are working through. And so, like for instance, you know, this is on demand and live. Sometimes we have to do step away from the camera for a second. And it's totally unscripted. And so life happens for sure. But with
just futzing with dogs and children and other things as they come
along.
Yeah, this is what it's like to be a mom and pop business.
Welcome to the family. And so in this world of monofloral honey, what happens, beekeepers will bring the hives into an area where the particular blossom is blooming in that very short window. They need to bring them in right after the bloom starts, and they need to take them away right before the blooming ends, because what they want to do is make sure that for that period of time the bees are really only going to those super high quality pollen sources, and then they can put the seal on it that it's monofloral, which is super cool. The way that bee honey gets produced, the way that these creatures create honey, is that the worker bees fly out, and over the course of a day, they'll visit about 100 different flowers, at least, to capture pollen, to capture the sugars, these super complex sugars that exist on the flowers, and then, or the nectar of the, and then what they'll do is they consume it. It goes into their honey stomach, which is one particular stomach, and the enzymes in that stomach break down the complex sugars into simpler sugars. They fly back to the colony. They expel that honey. A hive bee will actually then take the honey and put it into their stomach, and the enzymatic reactions will continue. And then at that point, the honey will be expelled into the comb. The hive bee will do that, and then the hive bee will seal the comb for future use. Or right before that, actually, it flaps its wings thousands of times to actually dry out the honey, remove any water in it. And honey has preservative powers because part of the enzymatic reaction creates two things, and one of those things is hydrogen peroxide. So there's a dry source of sugar with hydrogen peroxide. So there have been sealed honey pots found in Egyptian tombs that are perfectly consumable. So it kind of can last forever. And in that process, the beekeeper will then come and remove one edge of the comb, the seal, one side of it, and then that honey will then drain out. And so the honey, beekeepers that we work with actually spend a great deal of effort managing, you know, you can't take away the food source for the colony. There's a certain balance, how much honey you can take from a hive before it's too much. And so we don't tend to work with industrial scale producers who would potentially do that and put the colony at risk. So this is a kind of an ongoing working relationship with hive and beekeeper. And so it's pretty amazing.
And also, like these honeys, as John said, we hope you're not disappointed with the sticks. If we did jars of these honeys, this package would be $200+. So this is a way that we have, you make it accessible for the tasting. But these honeys can be pricier. We sell a Tasmanian leatherwood honey or
Kiawe honey. $26 a
jar.
Little jar.
And so why is that? Well, now you know so much work that goes into it, as well as the fact that a bee can produce in its lifetime, I think 1/12
of a
teaspoon of honey. And it's lifetime. So it just shows you how much work it goes into these worker bees then producing it and the beekeepers who help make it a sustainable process.
So yeah, and so then, this is our love letter to the bees, basically.
And the other thing as we get started, and yes, you get to taste, thank you, John, by the way, for that really great introduction.
So cool.
Is that there are honeys that are pure honey. This is pure honey. Nothing is added into it. There are also honeys which have infusions and flavorings added to them. So for instance, a truffle honey, many people love truffle honey. They add usually truffle oil into it or some sort of, but we did have a truffle honey for a while that they had flakes of truffles into it. And at farmers markets all the time, we see like blueberry honey and those things, and they have added flavoring into it. That's not bad. It's just completely different from these. What this means when you see orange blossom honey, blackberry honey, it means what does that tree or plant or flower tastes like when the bees go pollinate that item, that bush, that living organism, and then come back and make honey. So nothing else has been added to it. And throughout the tasting, let's talk about why certain honeys crystallize or not. Any other myths we can dispel about honeys for you along the way, we're gonna try to do. Okay, but first, we're cheese people. Let's get some cheese in you. All right.
Let's do it.
The first cheese we're gonna eat.
Cleanse your palate.
Okay.
I think it's good in between different tastings that all of us cleanse our palates.
Yes.
I think it's a great idea.
Okay, so first up is our fresh cheeses. If you want to go more in depth on any of our Cheese 101, again, our Cheese 101 class is a great way to do that. So we're going to kind of move through those. But your fresh cheeses are like mozzarella, burrata, ricotta, fresh chèvre, which we're doing today. Chèvre just means goat. They can be eaten the day they're made, really ideal within a couple weeks, meant to express, show the full expression of a delicious flavored milk. And they're always bright white in color. If anything, when you smell them, this one doesn't have much smell. They smell like lactic, like milk or like yogurt, a little. And then what else do I want to say about them? Oftentimes used for cooking cheeses, but can be really amazing just eaten on their own. So we're going to dive right in today. This is a perfect wake up your palate,
get it going.
This is a fresh goat milk cheese from Vermont Creamery out of Vermont. I don't know why I said that. John's like, no, Kendall, get on it, girl. This is from Vermont Creamery out of Vermont, y'all. Imagine that, not out of California. This is a certified B corporation, which means they pass all of these standards and tests that they are putting more into the economy and the environment then they are stripping away from it. It's a very limited amount of businesses. Patagonia is a B Corp, Rogue Creamery is a B Corp, but it's very difficult to prove that your company is basically doing good enough to be honored with that. So goat's milk cheeses are always tangy, acidic, bright, minerally, sometimes a little bit citrusy, like I get zest, lime zest, orange zest on them. So this is a great way to start our palate off. And when we talk about acid when you eat these, it's just that it like produces saliva on the sides of your mouth. It makes your mouth water. So I'm going in.
Yeah, and so this cheesemaker began in 1984. So it's one of our oldest American cheesemakers. Allison Hooper is one of our dear friends, as a past president of the American Cheese Society like me. And
she started the company with Bob Reese,
and they make some of the best soft ripened bloomy rind goat's milk cheeses in the country, but their fresh cheeses and then their butters are out of control good. They were acquired by Land O'Lakes just a few years ago because of the quality of their butter, which is just amazing. And so Allison is such a leader in this industry. Her goat's milk is incredible. Quality of the cheese is outstanding.
She's considered one of the main precursors. We call them the goat ladies of the 80s, but the women who brought back artisanal cheese making in the United States.
That's really good today.
I know.
That tastes so good. I love that cheese.
It is a perfect little amuse-bouche, which amuse-bouche is just a perfect bite, but to wake up your palate. Okay, yeah.
So we paired this with black button sage honey. So this is from California scrublands, from Z Specialty Food. The Geldners have been operating for over 35 years, focused on really like regenerative stuff, creating a better impact in the world. And we'll taste a couple of the honeys that they procure and source and create. But this is black button sage. It's a name for like the pillowy buttons of purple flowers that grow on it. And it's very light and delicate, golden white almost. Like you can, it's pretty beautiful. Like it's a very light honey. And one of the things that you can expect from honey, just like cheese, like wines and stuff, it's the lighter the color, likely the lighter the flavor profile or the softer the finish. And so that's something you can see, all the different varieties and shades of color that we have on the plate. But this one's gonna maybe taste like fresh lavender, maybe pear. I don't know if you picked any of that up. Hint of ginger, I don't know.
It's delicious. I think it tastes sweeter than it is because we went from the tanginess of the goat's milk cheese straight into that. So it really brings out that sweetness. And then when I put them together, I got more balanced
flavor profile.
I just poured a little cute little dollop right on my piece of cheese. And whenever we're pairing, we're looking for complementary flavors that work well together. So something really acidic with acidic, or strong with strong, earthy with earthy, or we're looking for contrasting flavors that work really well together. And that's what's so fun about cheese and honey, is that sweet and salt tangy combo. It's delicious, right? And if you, like, whatever bubbles you have to just pick up those fats off your palate and let them dance and aromatize it for you.
I got, it became, the combination of the two became incredibly fruity.
Yeah.
Like the acid went away and I got like pear. I really got like ripe, really ripe pear.
After I've like, I had my bite a while ago, the sensation left in my mouth is that I've just had pear.
Like a juicy, wonderful pear. That is really wonderful. I love it. And that's the thing. You might be experiencing something different, but that sage honey is such a spectacular flavor profile. I just think it's so cool and very different than what you'd expect.
And we've also, if you're wondering, when do I eat the dried figs? Or I've got these amazing corn nuts, these Quicos corn nuts from a Petit Max in Spain. When do I eat these? These are just supposed to be playful bites in between times, in between pairings. As we're going to switch up your mouthfeel, the salt from those will be good as a little crunch and to provide texture. As we said, we always like engaging all of the senses. So,
to cheese number one.
Okay.
That was a great pair.
Cheese number two. Your second style of cheeses are your bloomy rind cheeses. The most famous ones are Brie and Camembert. You know them because they have this thin white skin or white rind on them. This is called the rind on the outside. Then you have the cream line and the inner chalky paste. The flavor profile of these style of cheeses is usually very vegetal. So think asparagus or cauliflower or broccoli cheese soup. Sometimes a little mushroomy and peat mossy. What is happening is the mold on the outside of this cheese, which is intentionally supposed to be there, is breaking down the proteins in the cheese to make it creamier. So if you had a really young cheese and you cut into it, it might still be chalky in the center. As it ages out, it gets creamier. So Brie, ideally, is creamy all the way throughout, and that's how it's aged that way. So I'm gonna see if you guys can, you see that squeeze on there? You can see a little bit of a different texture from that inner chalky paste and then that cream line around it. When you take a bite of this cheese, I would love for you to get just a bite out of the center first. This isn't the way I would normally eat this cheese, but I just want you to taste, what does that inner paste taste like? Then try to get a bite of just that cream line, and then a bite with the rind. And you're really getting three different cheese experiences in one.
Wow.
And today we are eating
petite creme.
I can't talk today.
You're doing amazing.
Petite creme from Marin in California.
So this is Marin French Cheese Company. They started in 1865. So they are the longest continually operated cheesemaker in the United States. And they focus on sourcing milk from within about 15 miles of their operation, mostly all cow's milk. This is just this really beautiful, delicate flavor profile. I love petite creme. I think that if you like sit down and eat this with berries, or you eat it with something savory like prosciutto, this can go with almost anything because of those
different... I want raspberries and prosciutto with it.
Perfect. Those different layers that Kendall explained give it a lot of versatility when it comes to flavors. And so when we are pairing now, what is interesting, right, is actually playing with the different aspects of that cheese to see where this orange blossom honey kind of stands out the best. So this is from EB Honey. It's a 60 acre farm.
I love launched this about. Honey. I want to pour this honey all over my body.
So
this, have this honey.
This was launched about 25 years ago. It's now 200 acres, I think. It's like a pretty big location. They focus on monofloral. Some cases they have to take their hives off property in order to get the monofloral. They don't have all of the plants growing. So this one is sourced by a friend. And it is coming from orange trees, right? So like this is typically produced in the southern states where we, you know, Texas, Florida, Southern California, like where the citrus grows. But when the trees bloom, you're gonna get this amazing, and maybe there's some other citrus sources, but you're gonna get this amazing, hopefully hint of like that acidity, the essence of like a zest, but you're not gonna taste any of the fruit in it, but let's see.
Oh, I skipped ahead. I already had the honey and the pairing.
Mm.
I'm a cheater.
Okay, tell us about it.
I just love the orange blossom honey.
Mm.
So I definitely
get it. It's so delicate.
Yeah, I get that fruitiness. I get, in my mind, the power of suggestion of zest, of that orange zest.
Totally.
What I love about this pairing is this shows how different things can be and can transform each other. So when I put the orange blossom honey onto this cheese, it made a completely different pairing, and it actually brought out this more earthy, mushroomy, white button cap flavor to me in a good way, I just ate mushrooms. It made this cheese more nuanced to me. That's the way I should say it. At the beginning, when I just had this cheese, it's a great cheese. It's lovely. I could taste all of those vegetal flavors that you normally get. When I put the honey with it, it brought out this other layer and complexity of flavor, specifically because I had a bite with the rind.
Mm-hmm. And with the rind, when I'm exhaling out, I'm experiencing cave-like environments,
mm-hmm.
which is cool because when I first took the rind, I didn't get that. So this orange blossom honey is adding depth and long finish to this cheese, which is kind of cool.
Yeah, that totally transforms itself. And when you look for pairings, you're trying to find, and we don't always knock this out of the park, you're trying to find a beautiful dance between two perfect partners who one isn't trying to outshine the other. Like, what is left on your palate at the end? Are they both still there? Can you sense them both in some way? Or is it delicious, but one is the showstopper? Like, I'm just here to make you look good. So there's all those different kinds of pairings. And this one today, I can taste both of them still on my palate, and they transformed each other into a different, third, unique experience.
That was awesome.
That was super cool.
Cheers.
People often ask to eat the rind or not, and I say rind is a terrible thing to waste. Or what else do I say? Be kind to your rind. No rind left behind. So all that is to say, eat the bite of the rind. If you like it, keep eating it and enjoy it. If you don't. Life is too short for rules. And these styles of cheeses, the rind really is meant to be eaten. Later in the firmer, harder cheeses, the cheese community is pretty split. Some cheesemakers and affineurs say, that rind absolutely is a part of my cheese and the cave and the terroir, and I want you to taste it and enjoy it. And other people say, no, that's the protective layer for what I'm growing inside. So really, it's give it a bite, and it really can matter with what you're drinking and pairing it with if you like it that day or not. So, okay.
Dang, that was good. Another palate cleanse. All right, get your palate ready for the next.
You're staring at me drinking wine. Did you want me to drink water instead of wine?
No. I was...
Why else are we on date night, honey? It's the habits of wine.
That's right. I'm loving it.
I don't know. I feel like there was some sort of look in his eyeballs while we were doing that. Okay.
Do I want more wine or not? I couldn't decide yet.
You're going in like, uh-oh, I'm doing wine. Okay. So next up are your washed rind cheeses. Washed rind cheeses, like the bloomy rinds, which get the name bloomy because they have little molds that bloom on them. Washed rind cheeses get the name washed rinds because they wash them in some sort of brine solution. So a salt water solution or a beer or wine, a cider, a Marc de Bourgogne liqueurs and spirits. But it's creating an environment that's so acidic that these other molds and spores that are usually in your caves and that you want to grow on your cheeses, the ambiance there. Instead, none of that can grow as much. And what allows it to be prolific is these additives and grow these B linens or Brevibacteria linens. And they help make this cheese, the rinds of it, a sort of sunset colored hue, orange, pinkish, reddish, sometimes a little bit wet looking. Washed rind cheeses are your stinky cheeses, y'all.
Oh, yeah.
So,
Some
of the other ones, sometimes blue and sometimes bloomy rinds, but washed rind cheeses are the ones that are often known for being really pungent. And usually the bark is louder than the bite, meaning they may be really aggressive on the nose, but you taste them and they're not as funky on your palate. Sometimes they're just as funky on your palate. So there's a lot to play with here. But the flavor profile is often really hearty. It's like a steak, but in cheese form. It's meaty, it's bacony, it's woodsy. Again, it depends on the cheese, but those are some of the general common descriptors of this. And today we are going with Taleggio. Mm. This is a name-controlled cheese, a DOP, and this is from Cidesa in Italy.
One of our all-time favorite cheeses.
Definitely get a bite first without the rind, and this is, and then one with the rind. This is one I like to enjoy all of it without the rind, and then I eat the rind separately as like this little crunchier face.
Treat, yeah, okay. It's like a second bottoms layer up of heaven. So Cidesa, so good. Make an outstanding grilled cheese sandwich right now.
Mm-hmm.
Cidesa is a company that was founded in 1927. And it was, at the time, a company that really acquired wheels of cheese from producers of this particular cheese just east of Lake Como, north of Milan. And Giovanni would actually just age these cheeses and then sell them in to the markets. And then they started getting into production. And so one of the things that they got into was Taleggio. Taleggio has been around historically since at least the 10th century, if not before. So it's a very old recipe. Comes in a square shape, which is a really hard shape
shape of this plate.
Yeah, it's a hard shape to age evenly and perfectly. And there's some rules and requirements around how Taleggio is made. And so they need to be followed in order to put the seal of the designation on the wheels of cheese. Kendall and I got to visit Cidesa in 2017 with our kiddos. And they work now with water buffalo, cow's milk, goat milk a little bit. They play with a lot of different things. But this Taleggio is one of our favorites. And the reason why you can get some Taleggios, because not all Taleggios created equal, on the rind, you can get super wet, damp, tacky. And this particular brand has this really nice, dry texture. So it's easier to handle. We sell a lot of these to chefs and things because they like to use it on pizzas and mac and cheese and stuff. So super awesome. And we paired it with our buckwheat honey. So this is from EB Honey, same folks as that orange blossom.
So I will admit, as before you go in, this is one of the more polarizing honeys.
Yeah.
How can honey be polarizing? But
yeah,
it's going to be different if you haven't had it before.
So you can see, you can't even see it against the color of my shirt. It's so dark. And that is because, so the way that the sugars kind of
smell this one,
come
y'all
together, you end up here with flavors of like molasses and malt.
I was going to say, it smells like molasses.
Yeah, so
sorghum-y.
Buckwheat blossoms are rich in nectar and can blossom throughout some of the fall, a little bit longer. Very dark color can signify more antioxidants as well. Honey can be a natural remedy for allergies. Honey can be natural, like, remedy for, like, cuts and things. And so this has a big pungent flavor and a long finish. So bottoms up.
Go for it. Make sure you smell it first. So we are in this pairing.
Love buckwheat honey.
Are marrying some funky with funky, and putting these together, it actually makes both of them more funky. So I just want y'all to, I get hay once I put them together.
Oh yeah.
Like horse hay, like you're in the barn with
the
horses
animal
eating hay, or alfalfa more specifically.
Alfalfa?
Yeah, like.
Like a really bright dried grass,
mm-hmm,
not the dried kind of hay that you get like around Halloween and stuff, but that is awesome. Yeah, buckwheat honey.
I did it with the rind. I actually preferred my bite with the rind with the honey.
Mm. Mm. Yeah.
isn't that crazy though, how different the transformation mm-hmm. can be when you put those two together?
And I think you have to have more cheese than honey.
Yeah, because this honey is a stronger flavor of honey.
Not an equal proportion. Okay. So welcome to the club. This is like, buckwheat honey is intense and I love every bite of it.
Mm. Okay.
Right.
Oh, while we're about to move on to the next one, again, Kindle words, we can do this today. One thing to note is that the honey that many of us grew up on in the little honey bear actually doesn't have much real honey in it, if at all. And those are like mass produced with corn syrup and other additives and things into them out of China or where have you. But just next time that you're just buying honey, look on the back of it and see what other additives it has in it and what ingredients are actually straight up honey.
Yeah.
Anyway, fun fact. Okay, let's cheers.
Cheers. Oh, you want water this time?
I'll
do it again. I need water. I need water.
I'm going wine.
All right.
You didn't know that you bought this or somebody gifted it to you just so you could watch the Antonellis eat
cheese. Have fun together. That's
hey,
part of
after
the fun.
All, we quit our jobs on our honeymoon. No joke. John turned to me on our honeymoon and said, I want to quit my job and do something in cheese. I was like, say what? But here we are over a decade later and just on this food journey and exploration and on a personal mission to spread joy one bite at a time. So we hope you're enjoying it. All right. Next up, our next three styles I'm going to introduce all at once, which is where we get a little catch up in time. And it's semi-soft, firm, and hard. And really, that's pretty self-explanatory. Semi-soft has some bend, look at that, before it breaks. Firm, you can start to bend and it'll break. And then hard, you really can't bend as much. Think Parmigiano Reggiano. What is the difference in semi-soft, firm, and hard? And what are the applications? Well, age plays a big role. The longer you age a cheese, the harder it becomes because it's getting drier and the more moisture it's losing. The process of making cheese is separating the curds from the whey, the liquids from the solids. And so when you make a cheese and you want to keep it semi-soft, because you know that's going to be the best age and most flavorful for it, you're going to leave those curds really big and plump so that they will maintain and retain that moisture and whey. And you're going to treat them very gently as you scoop them out. Versus if you're trying to make a hard cheese, because you know that that's going to be the best flavor profile aged out after 6, 8 months, a year, 2 years, 5 year Gouda, what have you, you want to expel all that moisture because moisture is not your friend in the aging process. So not only do you cut those curds really small, but then when you have your form cheese, you press it and expel it all out. These semi-softs are great for mac and cheese, grilled cheese, fondue. So these, you need that moisture content still in the cheese to melt it and keep it melting. With that, let's dive on in to one of the first cheeses we ever knew we'd carry in the shop. We have done goat's milk cheeses, which are tangy, acidic, cow's milk cheeses, which are grassy and buttery. Now we move to sheep's milk cheeses, which are the richest in fat, often thought to be nutty, and give it a go as John introduces without further ado,
Oso Irati. So good, y'all. This is one of my all-time favorite cheeses. This comes from the Pyrenees Mountains. This is a co-op, a business called Onatic. This cheese, Oso Irati, is historically significant to the region, so it's name controlled, and multiple producers can make it as long as they follow the rules. We have found that from the versions that we can get in the country, this is our favorite. The sheep milk is just really rich. It's slightly dense, kind of luxurious on your palate. And it gives you these sort of like almost tropical fruit notes. It's one of our shop's most popular cheeses since day one. It's got this beautiful natural rind, so feel free to take a little nibble of it to try the rind. But this cheese has changed my life in the best kind of way. And we are pairing it today with yellow star thistle honey. This comes from a weed. Well, it's a plant, but most people consider it a weed. And this is from Northern California.
Jazz hands.
So Food and Wine magazine has called this the champagne of honey. This is, it had been the founder of Z Specialty Food early on was harvesting this honey and just giving it away until he realized that that was just unsustainable. And that's where the company founded. And he started selling these. These are yellow star thistle honey. It's becoming harder and harder to get. And beekeepers have to vie now for best access to the honey, to the densest stands of star thistle honey, so, or star thistle. So this is special. This is probably one of the top honeys in the country for sure.
That was delicious. The reason for the jazz hands was it kept changing on my palate. Like I just got all these different multi dimensions. So it almost felt like if I was eating glitter, I think.
Glitter.
Our little glitter balls that just all like, ooh, pop, 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 pop. Or maybe like boba seeds.
So.
And then when
creme brulee, I got creme brulee.
Mm,
like a little hint of banana. Mm.
And when I paired it with the cheese, this was a magical pairing to me that really complimented. When I paired it with the cheese, it was delicious. Then the cheese really stood forward and I thought I lost the honey. And as I've sat here, the honey has just delicately come back through and said, don't worry, I'm still here.
Picture the best creme brulee you've ever had right now and then exhale out. That's what I'm getting.
Yeah.
Wow. That was awesome.
Okay.
That was
awesome. I feel like it's probably going to be all downhill from here. That was a really good pairing.
Nope. I don't know. I'm not giving up.
Cheese number 5. We are going to a goat's milk cheese. So we were in Basque country, which, you know, they don't really prefer to be called French or Spanish, but that French Basque. And now we are going to Spain, to Toledo for La Dama Sagrada. So if you have ever had a sheep manchego, which is sheep's milk, this is a similar play on that, only it's made in a different region and with goat's milk. Take it away, John, on our firm cheese.
This is our La Dama Sagrada, sacred lady.
Give it a smell.
So as Kendall said, it's made by one of our favorite producers in Toledo, near Toledo. And they make classically sheep's milk versions, but they decided to make a goat's milk version. So what we're gonna get, manchego often has a like sweet nuttiness to it. And so you're gonna get some of that because of the make process, but it's gonna hit with a little acid. And so it's always fun.
Especially after that last pairing of the richness, this I got tangy, like that goat's milk is there and tangy.
Mm-hmm.
So this is going to be a fun pairing where we're going to do a sweet and tangy, like a simultaneous.
Very cool texture on it too. Mm-hmm. I love it. So it's Murciano goat's milk.
It's not a drier cheese, but it has the sensation of being drier with that texture.
With that texture, maybe after the different things that we've been consuming. So
okay. Also, this is our first raw milk cheese. We can sell any raw milk cheese in the United States as long as it's aged over 60 days. So it's funny, when we first opened our shop, people would come in and be like, psst, do you have any raw milk cheese? And we're like, yeah, half the case. Well, anyway, legally, it is illegal to sell raw milk cheeses aged under 60 days in the United States. But if it's over 60 days, it can be made with unpasteurized milk, which some people argue allows you to taste more of the full expression of the milk.
Wow.
All right, so what honey? We're doing blackberry
honey. Awesome. It's amazing. It tastes like little berry. There's no blackberry in this at all.
It's just so crazy how different the honeys are from one to the next. So you don't realize it until you do them back to back to back.
So wild blackberry bushes grow in the temperate zone, very much in the northern states of the U.S. and in Europe. We tend to get most of the blackberry honey that comes, that's produced in the states from like Oregon and Washington. And so this one is EB honey again. And this... again, you can see it's a light texture, so it's going to be light on the palate, but I got a little bit more like, my brain said raspberry rather than blackberry, but there's a like little hint of bitterness that you might be like that bitterness and the sourness that you get with like an unripe berry. I get a hint of that on my palate.
I'm going to try it again. Because I was wondering did you do the pairing? That come from the pairing? Okay, you thought it was just the honey?
Yeah. Again, like on the back of my mouth, I get like a hint of a tanginess with that.
Yeah, I didn't get that the first time. You're right.
So, and now I'm going for the pairing.
It is simultaneously very sweet to me. I get extremely a lot sweet of that sweetness. So that was the first thing I thought, is that this hit my palate sweeter than all the other ones did yet. And I was surprised by that. But now I'm getting more of that dimensionality of that tangy.
And with the acid of the... of the cheese, I think you get even a little bit more of that.
Clearly, I didn't like it, y'all.
So good. This cheese is just stunning.
Let me think on it while I keep eating it over and over. So that was a fun play. Oh, what did that pairing do for you?
Well, I think the tanginess of the goat's milk pushed out away that little hint of sour, that tanginess that I got from the honey, and just played with the sweetness is what ended up happening. It was good. I'm just like addicted to this cheese right now.
Okay.
Is what the problem is, I think. So, thank you all for being with us today. This is awesome. What a great opportunity to be together.
Okay. So, we're on to cheese number 6, your hard cheeses. These will be your worst melters, but oftentimes they're a great way to add a little bit of a salt or just flavor punch to a dish with a little grating over it. And we are hitting up Croatia with our first mixed milk cheese. This is sheep and cow. So we're gonna combine the richness of that sheep's milk with the buttery grassiness of that cow's milk over from the Isle of Pog.
Yeah, so Pasci Sirana is the cheesemaker, the cheese company. Their flagship cheese is Pasci Sir. It's won best cheese in the world before, and it's 100% sheep milk from the Isle of Pog with Pog sheep. So sheep that really originated there, the breed. It's really rocky, and so the vegetation has to work a lot harder to grow and survive. Well, that's the metaphone.
Well, that was with it.
I know.
Did I screw it up?
Okay. They mixed it up. It's that other one.
Thank you.
And so, because I've been so looking forward to these two next honeys.
Okay.
The whole tasting. And so, the Isle of Pog, with the fact that vegetation has to work so hard to grow, means that there's like a bit more like salt and heartiness to it. That translates into the milk. And now, so Dalmatinets is this great cheese. It's 90% cow's milk. So sheep only lactate about 6 months in a year. So in order to be able to make cheese year round, you need other sources. So they are using similar recipes and processes, but using 90% cow's milk. So you're getting more buttery caramel notes in this than you would have with the Pasci Sir, but it is an outstanding showstopper.
Well, John gives it a bite. I, just in case you're wondering, artisanal cheese varies batch to batch and by what age we get it in. So mine was actually a little more semi-soft or firm than it was a hard cheese. So just in case you're like, wait, something is a little off. It just can vary. And some other things to talk about are lactose. Folks often say, oh, I can't eat cheese. It doesn't agree with me. I'm lactose intolerant. Well, just know that in making cheese, you're converting lactose into lactic acid. And in the first 3 to 4 hours of making cheese in a vat, almost all the lactose has disappeared and been converted. And so, especially in aged cheeses, there's none, if any, trace amounts of lactose. So if you eat cheese and your belly still gets a little bit hurt, it's probably a protein allergy. So some folks have trouble processing the fat globules, proteins in cow's milk cheeses because they're really big and beautiful. But they can more easily digest goat's milk cheeses. So start with aged goat's milk, then to aged sheep's milk, and then working yourself back in age, and really see where it is on the protein allergy scale that it is troubling you. What are the things that most affect flavor? Now you know it's the species of animal. Is it cow, goat, sheep, water buffalo, yak, horse, camel? What is the breed of that species? So is it Mont-Belliard cows or Jersey cows or Holstein? They all make a different composition, flavor, milk profile. And lastly, what's the seasonality? What are the animals eating at that time of year? Where are they at in the lactation cycle? Okay, I gave you time to catch up.
I loved it. This is awesome.
I got a little bit of that zingy on my tongue from this cheese.
Mm-hmm.
How are we doing with okay, we're going coriander. Here we go. Coriander bottoms up.
Coriander honey was my best food bite of 2017, y'all. Best food bite of 2017.
Cotton candy. You're like, no. I taste cotton candy at a circus as a kid.
That's amazing. I was going with like gingerbread.
I mean, clearly I get
cotton candy works
of that, but
cardamom. I don't know. I'm like making stuff up. That's part of the fun of it. But coriander honey is
you've got two different sticks.
Coriander honey is one of those really fun flavor profiles that is unique, right? It's like, this is cilantro. Coriander mm-hmm. and cilantro are the same thing. They're just different words to represent the same thing. So in the South, in Texas, we eat cilantro on like everything. And then here we have the blossom, the honey, showcasing so very differently.
I do get this hint of spice in the back of my throat.
Again, sweetness. This cheese isn't as dry as I'd expect it to.
Mm-hmm.
So,
which we paired it with the more aged version. So hopefully you're getting the more aged version.
So I was hoping that like there's this
almost
earthy, herbal, herbaceous note coming from the honey that would play really fun with one of our really aged cheeses. So mm-hmm. hopefully you guys are experiencing that. I love coriander honey. It's one of my all-time favorites.
I love that honey. I love the cheese. This was a good pairing, but of our six pairings so far, this was a great example in the ages that we have on our plate right now. They, I don't know that one elevated the other. They were just like, oh, that was a good cheese and honey. Just as we own our journeys through here. All right.
All right.
So
here we go, y'all.
We're going to end on the best one yet. Cheese number 7.
Yeah.
All right. We're moving to perhaps the most polarizing blue cheeses. Blue cheeses, when the liquid is in the vat, you inoculate the liquid with the mold that derives from Penicillium roqueforti, roquefort being one of the first blues we know of. And then later, when you have your mold or your form of cheese, you go and pierce it. And you're not injecting any blue mold into that cheese. What you're actually doing is just allowing oxygen to hit the mold that's already there. And because that mold is aerobic, that's what allows it to grow those colors, or what we call veining. So it grows blue veins, gray. Well, I actually looked down and I have some gray, but blue, green, and yellow, all of that comes from that oxygen hitting the mold. You may have had blue cheeses that were never pierced, and so they didn't have that veining inside of them. There are some blue cheeses, if you don't like blue cheese, just know that there are some that are cool on your palate and fudgy and creamy.
Like this one.
The one we're going to do today. Mm-hmm. There are some that are more piquant and slap you on the face or hit you in the gut. So there's a whole gamut out there of blue beyond just what you think of as the ubiquitous blue crumbles. The only thing I wanted to show before I throw it over to John was you can almost see in this piece a perfect little needle point. You see that perfect round dot in the middle? Right there is where that needle went and shot right down. And you may be able to see, here's on this side, that line that goes straight down, that's where the needle went down and then the oxygen allowed it to vein. All right. And blues are often known for being pretty salty either way. Take it away, John. What are we eating?
We are having Baba Blue from Carr Valley in Wisconsin. This is coming from Sid Cook. He's a fourth generation cheesemaker and a master Wisconsin cheesemaker. He operates makes 80 different plus recipes, operates a handful of different plants, handful of different cheese shops. It's a really robust and big business. And I imagine there's going to be a fifth generation coming up at some point. It's a family business. It's amazing what they're doing. And Baba Blue is this beautiful sheep's milk cheese. It's, as Kendall said, there's two types, but the piquant and the creamy. This is more tends towards creamy. It's got some lanolin, some of that like note of animal, which I think is totally great and totally fine.
Like you can tell it comes from an animal, but it doesn't taste like you're licking on the animal.
We don't want that, sure. And so we've paired this with Meadow Foam honey, which is one of my new loves, right? I just found this honey in middle of this year and just became introduced after searching for years for new honeys. So these blossoms bloom, and Meadow Foam is more like a ground cover. And so when this is in blossom, it sort of looks like foam, like the foam on an ocean or there's a layer of foam on the meadows. And so they call it meadow foam, and it's this really dark color, much like that buckwheat, but the flavor profile in this is more like the aroma of like baking cupcakes or like a toasted marshmallow, and it's just really fun.
Mm, I love that honey. That is one of my favorites. And after you've seen the buckwheat and your eyes associate it with like, it's gonna taste like that because it's the darker color profile. And then actually putting it with this Baba Blue. I think it's a perfect dance. It's hard to stand up to a blue and without being aggressive. And they went back and forth. I actually think with one, maybe two of the other ones, this was the most successful pairing of the two of them playing together and bringing something new to the fold.
Being kind to each other. Oh, that is so good.
That was a delicious pairing. Okay,
that was wonderful.
Y'all, congratulations. Now is your time to just get to mix and match and play with all your bites. We hope you have enjoyed cheese and honey tasting. We're right at the 1 hour mark and we promise to get you on your way in life and doing what you will. We know it is fast paced and pandemonium and crazy out your doors. So thank you for just taking this moment to sit down and be and enjoy with us and celebrate the labor of love that is in front of you. We are a mission driven business to do good, eat good. For us, that means we support artisans who treat their lands regeneratively and sustainably, their herds and bees humanely, their teams ethically, and they make a delicious product that is easy for us to support. And in turn, when you support us and buy it, you are a part of that Do Good, Eat Good mission, and we give back to our community through our annual philanthropy plan and our monthly charitable cheese causes. So thank you for being a part of that Do Good, Eat Good mission. We hope if you're ever in Austin, you can come travel and see us. We give bites of everything for free and fun, and we are proud to be an award-winning cheese shop. We never would have thought that would be the case when we set out on this dream over a decade ago. And either way, we'd love to keep coming at you and joining you in your home or for your next company party or birthday party. We do ship nationwide, and in fact, we even do global virtual team tastings. We switch these pairings up every 4 months or so. So just know if you love cheese and honey, there will be a new edition in a couple months. And with that, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for being a part of our mission. It's Kendall and John, Antonelli's Cheese, signing out. Way to go, cheese and honey. And we hope you have a great day.
Bye, y'all.